Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Victory at Villers-Bretonneux, Why a French Town Will Never Forget the Anzacs, written by Peter FitzSimons and read by Robert Meldrum. To Sapper William Charles Wilkinson, the great-grandfather of my children, a gentle and good man, who served bravely with the 58th Battalion of the 15th Brigade in the second of the battles at Villers-Bretonneux, buried many of his mates there, and, like so many of the survivors, returned to Australia to rarely speak of it again. A century on, this is their story. We knew you would fight a real fight, but we did not know that from the very beginning you would astonish the continent with your valour. I have come here for the simple purpose of seeing the Australians and telling them this. I shall go back tomorrow and say to my countrymen, I have seen the Australians. I have looked into their eyes. I know that they, men who have fought great battles in the cause of freedom, will fight alongside us till the freedom for which we are all fighting is guaranteed for us and our children. French Prime Minister Georges Clemenceau to the Australian soldiers, 1918. Past wars should be studied as flesh and blood affairs, not as a matter of diagrams, formulae and concepts, but of men. Hence, perhaps, an element of overemphasis on personalities in this book, and in particular on the personal ascendancy of the Australian soldier on the battlefield, which made him the best infantryman of the war, and perhaps of all time. British General Hubert Essam, CBE, DSO, MC, who fought with the Australians at Villers-Bretonneux. Our only disappointment is that Fritz has made such rapid advances, but it must please you to know that wherever he has met the Australians, he has come, what the boys call, a gutser, and has never advanced an inch. If only the Tommies would stand and fight like our grand boys, the state of things would be very different. At least I can say that I am proud to be an Australian, and if history is ever truly written, you will find they have done wonderful works, which the English papers cannot for their own sakes mention. Lieutenant Frank Reinhardt Fisher, 6th Battalion, writing to his brother and sister in Adelaide. A Yankee who could speak German asked a German prisoner, did he think they were winning the war? He replied, yes, God is with us. The Yankee replied, that's nothing, the Australians are with us. Diary of Sidney B. Young of Campsie, after 1,000 American soldiers joined 7,000 Australians to capture Hamel in 93 minutes on the 4th of July, 1918. Note on the text. For the sake of simplicity, Lieutenant Generals and Major Generals are referred to simply as Generals. Brigadier Generals are referred to as Brigadiers. Similarly, Lieutenant Colonels and Colonels are both described as Colonels. I also advise that left and right flank is always viewed from the position of a person within the unit under discussion and facing the enemy. German translations have been lightly edited to make their meaning clearer in English. While British, Australian, and German formations are all different, and with very broad brushstrokes, here is the rough size of the units that made up their forces in the Great War. One army group, Germans only, equals three or more armies, equals up to 1,200,000 men. One army equals 3 to 5 army corps equals up to 500,000 men. One army corps equals 3 or 4 divisions plus corps troops equals 70,000 to 100,000 men. One division equals 3 brigades and artillery equals 16,000 men. One brigade or regiment equals 3 or 4 battalions plus machine guns and mortars, equals 3,000 to 4,000 men. One battalion equals 4 companies plus battalion headquarters, equals 900 men. One company equals 4 platoons, equals 200 men. Background and acknowledgements. Herewith, the third book of my trilogy on the experience of Australian soldiers in the Great War. It has, and I mean this sincerely, been an honour, a privilege, and a fascinating exercise to track their experience through all of Gallipoli, Fromelles, and Pozières, and now their greatest triumph of all, the battles of Villers-Bretonneux. Like most Australians, my understanding of what happened at Villers-Bretonneux was somewhere between foggy and non-existent, up until a couple of decades ago. When writing the biography of John Eales, I cherished the story of the World Cup-winning Wallaby coach Rod McQueen taking the Wallabies to the town and then reading to them, in the last minute before they left the dressing room to go into the cauldron of Millennium Stadium, Cardiff, for the World Cup final, the words of Lieutenant Frank Bethune to his men, in one of the battles that preceded the main event, as the Germans were about to fall upon them. "This position will be held," McQueen quoted Bethune, "and the section will remain here until relieved. The enemy cannot be allowed to interfere with this program. If the section cannot remain here alive, it will remain here dead. But in any case, it will remain here. Should any man, through shell shock or other cause, attempt to surrender, he will remain here dead. Should all guns be blown out, the section will use Mills grenades and other novelties. Finally, the position, as stated, will be held." A dropped pin on that dressing room floor would have sounded like a clattering cymbal. "And guys," McQueen finished, "they held their position. Rah!" A couple of years later, while writing my book Kokoda, the Australian historian Neil MacDonald, who had become a great friend, showed me a passage from Charles Bean's official history, which thrilled me. The scene was set with the British line defending Villers-Bretonneux having been broken. The Germans were flooding west, and the Australian soldiers of the 3rd Division had been sent east to plug the gap. Coming back the other way down the road were many British soldiers, shouting such warnings to the Australians as, "You can't hold them!" Among the Brits were thousands of French refugees, many of them with all the worldly belongings they could carry in their wheelbarrows, and hence to the part I loved. As documented by Bean, some of the fleeing citoyens took just one look at the diggers and turned around, on the reckoning that with our blokes involved, the day might be saved after all. "Fini retreat, madame," Charles Bean recorded one of the diggers saying to an old lady heading west as he sits with his mates on a brief smoko, cleaning their rifles. "Fini retreat. Beaucoup Australiens ici." Loved it. But detail? No clue. Still, interest grew as I first took my 3 kids to Villers-Bretonneux on a family trip in 2007, to walk around the town, the battle sites and the cemetery, getting a very rough appreciation of what had happened. And then, having written books on Gallipoli and the twin battles of Fromelles and Pozières, the obvious subject of Villers-Bretonneux beckoned. And yes, you are right. Given the rather breast-beating way I had come by the story, I would have to be on guard from writing it in a breast-beating way, something I have struggled with since. For I frankly challenge anyone who goes into this story not to come away amazed at how well the Australians performed in extreme circumstances. As ever, I have tried to bring the story part of this history alive by writing it in the present tense and constructing it in the manner of a novel, albeit with 2,000-odd footnotes as the pinpoint buttresses on which the story rests. For the sake of the storytelling, just as I noted that I did with Gallipoli and Fromelles and Pozières, I have occasionally created a direct quote from reported speech in a newspaper, diary or letter, and changed pronouns and tenses to put that reported speech in the present tense. every now and then assuming generic emotions where it is obvious, even though that emotion is not necessarily recorded in the diary entries, letter, etc. I have also occasionally restored swear words that were blanked out in the original newspaper and diary accounts due to the sensitivities of the time. Always, my goal has been to determine what were the words used, based on the documentary evidence presented and what the feel of the situation was. For the same reason of remaining faithful to the language of the day, I have stayed with the imperial system of measurement and used the contemporary spellings. While I prized primary documents above all else, many books were wonderful sources, and none more, as ever, than the combined works of Charles E. W. Bean, including most particularly his diaries and notebooks. On that subject, I express here my deep gratitude to Edward Bean Le Couteur and Anne Marie Carroll, the grandchildren of Charles Bean, and owners of the copyright in his diaries and papers, for their kind permission to quote from the great man. All books used are listed in the bibliography, but of the works beyond Bean, I drew particularly heavily on George Mitchell's Backs to the Wall, Joan Scott's Diary of Private Edwin Need, Jimmy Downing's To the Last Ridge, Peter Kilduff's Red Baron, The Life and Death of an Ace, Martin Middlebrook's The Kaiser's Battle, and Robert Asprey's The German High Command at War. My friend, Dr. Peter Peterson, has written a great book, Villers-Bretonneux, which acted as a compass whenever I got lost and needed to get back to the front. Ditto my friend Ross McMullen with his wonderful biography, Pompey Elliott. In Germany, special thanks to Carmen Böhm from Bayerisches Army Museum, Bavarian Army Museum, in Ingolstadt, who went way above and beyond the call of duty. Steffi Wolf from the German National Library in Leipzig. Frank Anton from Bundesarchiv, Department Military Archive in Freiburg-Breisgau. The staff at Staats- und Universitätsbibliothek Hamburg, especially Marian Meyer. The Library of Helmut Schmidt Universität, Universität der Bundeswehr, Hamburg. Zentralbibliothek Recht and Zentralbibliothek Philosophie, Geschichte und Klassische Philologie, Geschichte in Hamburg. In the USA, Jenny Reibenspies from Cushing Memorial Library at Texas A&M University and Damani K. Davis from the National Archives in Washington, D.C. In the United Kingdom, I thank Diana Munnerpud at King's College London Archives, Andrew Goff at the British Library, Tricia Buckingham at the Bodleian Libraries, and back home, all the research staff at the mighty Australian War Memorial Research Centre, to name but a few. Just as with the first two of the trilogy, and indeed with nearly all my books for the last decade, I have relied heavily on a great team of researchers, most of whom have worked with me and substantially with each other for many years. As with Fromel, the major digger for the diggers, trawling through diaries and letters, was Dr. Noel Borum. We respectfully think of him as Noel the Diary Mole, who spent many happy weeks finding so many of the original accounts and quotes you will find herein, as well as doing valuable work vetting the manuscript at its completion. Mein Freund, Sonja Gernitz, meanwhile, is a dual German-Australian citizen who first started working with me for my book Tobruk in 2005. For this book, it was very useful that she was living back in Germany for most of the time I was writing it, enabling her to go in person to the many archives and libraries to find the material to bring to life the German experience at Villers-Bretonneux. Her ability to locate and then translate long slabs of German regimental histories, her understanding of the language and culture of the time, was crucial to turning up fresh material for this account and fine-tuning it to accuracy. Dr. Libby Effney has worked with me on the last three books, and as a researcher and friend, she is as good as it gets. Hard-working and, curiously, as intellectually strict as she is creative, in working out how the story can be told better while still remaining within the parameters of what happened. I mentioned in the last book how, of all my favourite notations to researchers, foremost was LMEPR, as in Libby Maria Effney, please resolve. using the intellect and patience I don't possess, to wade into this tangle of differing accounts with footnotes from everywhere and come up with a sole, solid quote sourced to an original document we ideally have a screenshot of. Bingo. Done. Move on. So too with this one. And she was also wonderful in coordinating my other researchers to work out just who was best equipped to find the answer to whichever question I posed. Finally, my warm thanks to Dr. Peter Williams, the Canberra military historian who has worked with me throughout this trilogy. He was the one to give me the first detailed tutorial involving salt and pepper shakers on what happened during the Villers-Bretonneux battle, and as we have gone on, things have become ever more precise. Time and again I relied on his depth and width of knowledge, his 40 years of study in the field, not to mention his extensive library of wartime literature. He and I both particularly enjoyed, nearing the end of the book, putting together Sonia's translations of the German accounts of the battle, and working out just where the German piece of the jigsaw puzzle should be placed in my account, to give the proper counterpoint to the Australian accounts. I give him particular credit for cross-referencing the Leutnant Rossbach account with other German reports, to work out exactly where Rossbach and his men must have been placed at the time, which Australians they fought, and what time the scene took place. I might say, in passing, I have long found the special joy of putting together such historical works is indeed finding the right jigsaw piece to put in the right spot. It fits, it fits. For while history itself, of course, meshes perfectly, putting together parts of different historical accounts can be a lot more challenging. And rewarding when it brings the whole scene to life. As ever, I also relied on other specialists in their fields, including my wonderfully assiduous long-time researcher at the Australian War Memorial, Glenda Lynch, together with her fellow researcher, Jean Main. My dear friend, Dr. Michael Cooper, for medical history, Gregory Blake, for his assistance in all matters to do with firearms and artillery, and Matt McLaughlin of Battlefield Tours for vetting the whole manuscript and suggesting additional angles and stories. In this book, it was a joy to revisit and refine some of the same material I first became fascinated with during my biography of Charles Kingsford Smith, most notably the life and times of the Red Baron, Fokkers, Sopwith Camels, and the whole aerial war in France. And, as with that book, I relied on the expertise of aviation expert Peter Finlay to help on all matters esoterical. My thanks also to the descendants of the Australian soldier Archie Barwick, who gave their blessing to use his diarised words to strengthen my account. As to illustrations and maps, I am once more indebted to Jane McCauley, whose great work you will see throughout. And I might say,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.